Hello everyone, my name is Diego Alfonso and one of your hosts with the Florida Aviation Network. Broadcasting live and in the clear from the Florida Air Museum at the Sun and Fun Complex in Lakeland, Florida. During the 40th annual Fly-In and Expo in Lakeland. Today, our guest is, if you're in aviation, you probably know of him or know him, simply because this gentleman, it's kind of becoming a household name, so to speak, of all those of us who enjoy aviation and everything else. So without any further, I'd like to introduce you to Kermit Wicks.
Hey, Diego, thanks for inviting me. Appreciate it.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have you here. I'll tell you. The first thing I would like to do for the benefit of our audience is to let you kind of walk us through your life as a pilot from the beginning, the dream. Where did that came from, and how you progress through the years to where you are today as a pilot?
Yeah, great. Well, I think everybody can look back on their life and see those little key points that brought you where we are today. And in my case, the first glimpse, very early on, I was fascinated by a lot of things, mechanical. I built things, dreamed and imagined, brought my dreams into fruition. I'm still doing that, although they've gotten a lot bigger and a lot more expensive.
That's right.
But what happened is the first inkling of airplane interest, I was 8 years old. I built a biplane. I put two boards together, some boards between them. I strung some string because I knew it had wire in there. I wrote Curtis on the top of it. And I set it on a set of wheels, some bike tires, that I had a little rod on, but it wasn't connected. Engineering was a little bit beyond my ability at that time, but I was very ingenious. What I did is I set the whole wing structure on top of my toy radio flyer wagon, and I'd go down the street with the wind blowing in my face. And so that's my first thing of flying, but I was interested in a lot of things up till I was 13 years old, and I heard that song, Snoopy and the Red Baron, on the radio. And that was almost like a predestined cue to me that all my interest then became focused on aircraft and flight.
Right.
Read a lot of books about history and stuff. I started flying control line models, eventually radio control. When I was 15 years old, I ended up meeting a gentleman. He was an EAA member, my first exposure to the EAA. And he was building a home-built airplane in his garage. Concept fascinated because I like to build things. I like airplanes. He let me help out a little bit. The following year, when I was 16, thumbing through his magazines, I found an airplane that I wanted to build, a little open cockpit biplane. I bought a set of plans, because they didn't have kits back then. I taught myself how to weld up at the EA welding booth up at Oshkosh in 1971, the year I graduated from high school. And I built, last year of high school, I built most of my first flyable airplane. Went away to college for a couple of years, didn't get to work on it, but I eventually came home, finished it, test flew it myself when I was 21, and from there it was pretty much, I did gymnastics in high school, gravitated towards flipping around in the sky, soloed my last year of high school, and then I went on to fly 15 years with the U.S. Aerobatic Team and two airplanes I designed and built myself, the Week Special and the Week Solution. Won 20 medals at the world level, 2 times national champion. And then about my mid-20s, when the aerobatics was really going on, I ended up starting to collect vintage airplanes, and I now have the largest private collection of vintage airplanes privately in the world, rivaling a lot of national museums. It's about 165 airplanes in the collection. So,
wow.
Yeah, I'm in it really deep.
I know. And I'll tell you, it's commendable because the work you've done just trying to preserve our history and that era, that I don't think it'll ever come back. We're just seeing the remnants of it, and you're are tremendously cautious about taking care of them, and we really appreciate that.
Now, this is just from me to you. Yeah, the reality is, and everybody out there, love what you do and do what you love, and it's a passion for me. Even if people didn't like it, I'd be doing it, we got a lot of enthusiasts on site today, and through the week here at Sun and Fun, and that's kind of what it's all about.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't think of any place, I would rather be than not to be here this week. I mean, this is just a pilot's paradise, you know, so to speak. So when I read kind of some notes that I had on you, and you were born in Utah, correct?
Yeah, Salt Lake City.
Salt Lake City. You know, that's my favorite state.
Really?
I'm not from this country. You probably didn't know that.
No, I couldn't.
It's very
tell.
Hard to.
I thought maybe that was a Southern Georgian accent.
But of all states, I don't know why I fell in love with Utah.
Really?
Because the scenery.
Yeah.
And another thing is, I went to the lake, and I tasted the water.
Yeah.
And it is salty.
It is salty.
Because
yeah.
I couldn't believe that was salt water. So actually, we did this, my wife and I. I said, we're going to go over there, and then we're going to taste that water. So
you go swimming in there, and you float. Great.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
right. So you were born in Utah, and then you migrated. How did you find your way to Florida?
Well, my father was transferred. He was a petroleum geologist, so we ended up in California. Eventually, he ended up working for the government for the NOAA. You know, National Oceanographic Institute. And he got transferred to Miami, which was great for us because I got transferred down there. It was like my ninth grade. I was about 13, 14. And we ended up, it was just a great place to fly airplanes.
Yep.
I mean, Miami is a zoo down there now. It's just so overrun where we were. It was all open fields where we went flying. And it was a great place for me because of my interest with airplanes and flight. And, eventually, I was kind of pretty much led to Central Florida. I was in a lease situation when I opened the Weeks Air Museum in 1985. I had out collected the facility before we ever moved in. It took about 5 years to permit it and open the museum. And I continued to collect airplanes. And when we opened in 1985, I had way more airplanes than I can fit in a hangar. So what happened was I had been working on Central Florida, the fantasy of flight a concept for a number of years, and pretty much Hurricane Andrew kind of put an end to basically Act One, you know. And we had been working on the concept for fantasy of flight for about 4 years, and literally 4 months after the hurricane hit, they handed me my permit. And within about 2 months, we were digging dirt here in Central Florida. So Fantasy of Flight opened in 1995, 10 years later. We've been open 18 and a half years. And I think most people know out there, if they read aviation stuff, we're closing the doors to the public this weekend. This is gonna be our last week of operation. But what when Andrew kind of finished Act One, all great stories come in three acts, okay? So Miami was Act One. When we came out of the ground here, that was pretty much the beginning of Act Two. This weekend's the end of Act Two. And so basically, after a short intermission, get some popcorn, we're going to be back to begin Act Three. And I realize now that I've kind of been almost led to Central Florida, to my piece of property, to now create something that doesn't exist. You know, I learned very quickly after I opened the doors that pretty much all the aviation enthusiasts on the planet are on this airfield here this week.
Yeah.
And there wasn't enough for me to really pay my light bill. I love airplanes. There's a lot of aviation enthusiasts. And as I began to think, you know, what could I create that touched everybody that came through my doors? Because not everybody likes airplanes, but what I realized was everybody at some level has a fascination for flight. I defy to come up with a better metaphor for pushing our boundaries, reaching beyond ourselves, and freedom.
Right.
And within the physical, everybody in their own way can relate to reaching for the sky, reaching for the stars. But within us, you know, we soar in our imagination and we fly in our dreams. So I realized the key to my future was in that metaphor of flight. So right now, while the concept that we're shutting down, the airplanes and history are pretty much an end product, when we reopen in the future as Act Three, they're going to be a means to an end. The airplanes are just going to be backdrop, set dressing. And I realized that, you know, the lessons of humanity haven't changed. They're never going to change.
Right.
Technology may change the means of delivery, but we're still going to be dealing with the same issues. So basically, I'm just going to use this metaphor of flight, the concept that something draws us beyond ourselves. I want to create a kind of a new theme park industry where, loosely based on the metaphor of flight, we'll deliver the initial aspect with aviation and history, but it's not about history. It's about using history to teach about yourself.
Exactly.
And then eventually people will go through attraction elements on a Disney quality, potentially a Disney scale eventually, and literally self-discover and self-transform themselves for themselves. That's where I'm headed. If I can deliver that, I think I'm onto something big.
Well, I guess that's the essence of pilot. I mean, you really discover who you are after you become a pilot, especially when you go out there and you're flying by yourself. And,
yeah.
And there's a lot of self-thoughts process going on. And I'm pretty sure that that's going to be a success. And, of course, we're going to be looking after you on that. But I cannot let you go without asking, as a pilot, and I know you have been blessed with the fact that you've been able to fly so many different aircraft, and I guess the question that everybody in our audience will be thinking about or asking themselves is, and we're talking about now vintage aircraft, which aircraft is your favorite, and why?
Well, it's interesting. You know, normally my standard My standard answer for that, because I do get to fly a lot of airplanes, is whichever one I'm flying at the time.
Yeah.
But if you asked me the question in a different way and you said, if you had to get rid of all your airplanes and you could only keep one, I got to tell you, I haven't flown it yet. It's my latest acquisition, and it's sitting above my head behind me.
Okay.
I own the Howard Hughes Sikorsky S-43.
Oh,
it's sitting at Fantasy of Flight, that airplane right there, the seaplane. And Howard bought that in 1937 to fly around the world to set a world record. The war was beginning, and, or not beginning, but the war clouds were beginning in 1938. And another faster airplane came out. He was having some licensing issues were being delayed with the FAA with all the fuel tanks and stuff. Another airplane came out, Lockheed 14. He grabbed that. And part of the problem was the Sikorsky had a short range. And because of the speed, he couldn't make some of the legs because of the countries that were about to get in the war. So he got the Lockheed 14. He knocked 3 days off the world record, had a ticker tape parade down in New York City. And he eventually used this airplane in the testing of the Spruce Goose. They had an accident. He had sold the airplane to the government because they were taking up airplanes for the war effort, and he was kind of done with it. And he ended up borrowing it from the government. They had taken a bunch of weight out of the back of it, a lot of radio equipment, and had not put any ballast in, and he wasn't aware of it. They took off out of Las Vegas, and when they landed on Lake Mead, made a nice landing, because of the nose heaviness of the airplane, it dug in, it swung to the left, it broke the wing off. Two people immediately got killed. Howard almost got killed, and the guy that was in the best shape in the co-pilot seat, he got Howard out. The government had no interest in the airplane. Howard got the bill of sale back from the government, spent a lot of money bringing it up about 160 feet of water with U.S. Navy divers, rebuilt it at great expense, and basically flew it till about 1952, and now I own it. Pretty cool, huh? Thank you, Howard.
And when are you going to, what are the plans for when are you going to fly it?
Well, the airplane had not flown since 2005. I bought it in 2012, 7 years later. And when we looked at it, there was some corrosion on the hull.
Okay.
Some of the original wiring was there. And I really didn't have space at Fantasy of Flight right now. And the more I thought about fairing it, we were going to put a lot of money into getting it somewhere, put it at risk, get it there just to take it apart to rebuild it. I said, just take it apart in Houston is where I bought it. So we took it apart, and once Fantasy of Flight closes, we're going to finish up a couple of projects, and I'd like to get on it sooner than later. So
that airplane spells Caribbean.
Yeah. Howard used to fly all his Hollywood style girlfriends around in it. So,
and
cool.
If you're ever going to go down to Caribbean and you need an interpreter,
I need an interpreter. Good deal. Yeah. You and me at the Coca Cabana. Good deal.
I'll tell you, it's really a pleasure to have had this conversation with you. I really enjoy it. I'm pretty sure our audience is just as happy as we are. But unfortunately, we come to that time that we're going to have to say goodbye.
Yeah, we'll
And
go.
We're looking forward to see you again.
Good deal.
Wish you the best. I'm pretty sure that your success is just around the corner.
Thank you.
And we'll be looking after that.
And thanks for all that you've done, too. You guys have a great time. Follow your dreams. Light that spark within, and we all fly in them. So good
deal. There you go. And our audience, thank you so much for joining us. My name is Diego Alfonso with the Florida Aviation Network, and we'll be back pretty soon.